recurrent annual floods of Assam or earthquake, landslide or any other disaster, one sight that people await and are reassured by are the presence of men in orange. Yes, they are the country's premier saviors in disaster. The National Disaster Response Force, or NDRF, whose one-line motto written below their logo, Saving Lives and Beyond, Aapda Seva Sadev, summarizes the immense work towards mankind itself. Very recently, during the Assam floods, which have mercifully receded now, NDRF evacuated thousands of people and livestock, a service that they render every year. In an exclusive interview to Youth Folio, Director General of NDRF, S.N. Pradhan, who was previously a joint secretary with the Northeast Focus Ministry of Donair, talked at length about floods in Assam and role of NDRF.
Among all flood-affected states, Assam was the right at the beginning that we deployed. We started with about six teams initially, early in or late in May, around 20th May. But eventually we deployed 16 teams as per the requirement of the state government. We also deployed some teams in Arunachal Pradesh. We luckily have two deployments or two battalion formations in that area. One in Itanagar, which is called the 12th Battalion, and one in the one in Guwahati, which is called the 1st Battalion. So between the two of them, they deputed 16 teams because the other teams are also in other states of the Northeast. At one point of time, that was the highest deployment till Bihar had a serious flood situation and more deployment happened there. But even now, as we speak, the teams are on standby and we helped in the evacuation of more than 70,000 people and livestock also. And we rescued or saved 5,000 to 6,000 people who were in precarious conditions or stuck in the water. Overall, the situation has improved now, but as you said, you know, there is a issue of recurring floods in Assam. One of the reasons is that the riverine source is actually not inside Assam, but outside the country, not even in Arunachal Pradesh, but outside the country, which is in China. So there is an issue there, and unless there is some international agreement, there will always be an issue. Of course, there is a possible solution by damming the rivers somewhere in Arunachal Pradesh, and that process I think is going on.
Earthquake is another disaster that the Northeast is perpetually at a big risk. The NDRF has conducted many mock drills all over the region in schools, colleges and other places to prepare the populace about how to ensure minimum damage, how to rescue people caught in debris and disaster. But are these sufficient? Why is it that unlike many disasters like cyclones, one is not able to predict earthquakes in advance?
India happens to be have all the five seismic zones, 1 to 5. Unfortunately, Northeast especially falls mostly under zone 5 because it is much of it is sub-Himalayan, and the other part is old stone mountains which are liable to crumbling and landslides. So from Sikkim eastwards, it is a very sensitive seismic zone, and it is very important that the people are primed, just like Japan. I always give the example of Japan. People are primed to expect earthquakes and primed to react in a certain way during earthquakes. That is why we carry out a lot of trainings and awareness campaigns, not only in schools, but also with communities and college students. And pan-India, we have had almost 62 lakh people, citizens trained in different aspects of earthquake and other disaster response, community response.
The Northeast, especially the hill states, suffer hugely from landslides. Roads are blocked for days. At times, property is damaged and lives are also lost. Why are these a recurrent feature in the Northeast? are the landslides largely due to heavy deforestation and cutting down of mountains to make roads, as environmentalists say? What are the other factors?
Actually, much of it is hinged on urban planning. You see, most of the capitals of states like Mizoram and Nagaland, Kohima or Aizawl, are situated on the hillsides, and they are all old stone mountains. So even the continuum of the Chota Nagpur Plateau, which goes into northeast, and the Himalayan, sub-Himalayan part, which is also part of the northern part of northeast, all these are prone to landslides. More the southern part because of loose and old stone mountains. Now, naturally, any urban area which will be the capital, it will continue expanding. Once it expands, because there is less space and you are using the mountain sides, so there is obviously deforestation of the mountain sides. The forests hold the mountains together. So obviously there is a greater chance of landslides happening because it is all loose soil and loose rocks. So this is the reason why there is a lot of fear that if there is something above 6 or 7 Richter scale in northeast areas, it can do severe damage. So I think one of the ways of handling it or looking at it is looking at stable soil on which to make urban planning. There'll be, of course, it has to be a relatively better place for planning, because you cannot find certainly very stable soil anywhere in the state, maybe in Mizoram, or because it will be always be hillside. But within that, whichever is relatively stable, if you can look for that, and afforestation on a very large scale, and maybe plants like bamboo which holds the soil together, especially the hillside soil, and not allowing erosion, making the required structural formations to not allow erosion. All this is required, but more than that, more than anything else, what is required is that any infrastructure construction, it cannot be without giving a thought. You cannot think in terms of having multi-storied buildings or complexes when the soil itself cannot hold it.
Our next question to the DG was on COVID duties and preparedness of NDRF. One saw them at jobs spraying disinfectants, spreading awareness about do's and don'ts to stop spread of COVID infection, among other works. Some personnel were infected too. So what all are being done to safeguard the force, and what specific COVID-related duties are they performing?
The NDRF has, because it is a disaster response force, it has offered itself to all the states through a letter to the chief secretaries that we are on permanent standby. Whenever we are required for the COVID situation, we can be called. Many states have utilized our services for quarantine facilities, for sanitization drives, for medical testing drives, for specialized things like making the local police or the local civil defense or the local civil administration people at block level, panchayat level, or at the district level, aware about what to do, how to wear a PPE kit, for example. Even that is not sometimes it's lost sight of. It's very important. All these have been handled by NDRF on a massive scale. I think the biggest input that was given by NDRF was to the central government agencies, which are there in the various ports of entry, whether airports or land ports or seaports. All the ports of entry, the staff were trained and made aware by NDRF. That is almost 80,000 staff facing outwards, whether in the airports or the seaports or the land ports. We also were infected. As we speak, out of 480 odd, who were 475 NDRF personnel, all India, all over the country, who were infected out of those 13 battalions. Most of them have recovered. I think only a dozen or 20 or so who are still current cases, active but asymptomatic.
The NDRF personnel are drawn from all security forces. The team is made up of personnel on deputation. However, special disaster training is given to all. Mr. Pradhan appraises us about this.
NDRF is essentially a depletionist force. From the DG downwards up to the last personnel, we are a force on depletion. The DG is an IPS officer, the IG is an IPS officer. There are four DIGs who are from the paramilitary. DIG downwards, it is a 7-year deputation. Earlier it was 9 years, now it is a 7-year deputation. So they come and spend 7 years here as NDRF. So they are drawn from all the paramilitary forces, CRPF, BSF, ITBP, SSB. But now we also have Assam Rifles contributing. Assam Rifles has contributed one battalion. And SCISF also.
Last, we wanted to know about the man himself. What are the two things he loves doing and what are the two things that he fears?
The two things that I love are books and music, apart from playing with children. Not in that order, but I can take any of these and be happy. On the door of my hostel room in JNU was written, I am married to music and books. So that was the pachan of my, that is something I like always and I live by it. I don't really fear anything as such, except that I am very attached to the people in my family, whether the extended family and all. So I fear any hurt to any one of them. It is a scary thought. It's a scary thought. So those are my fears. The other fear in the profession is the times that we know, because it's a risky profession. I'm not bothered about myself, but you worried about your own people, your own staff,